Well, welcome back, everybody. I guess we're now in the afternoon on the first day of FinTech Generations 2020. And the content has been awesome so far. The conversations have been great in the chat, the certification program. I think people, after a morning, are really starting to get a handle of Umbrella and how do you Slack to keep the conversations going. So hopefully it'll happen. Would really encourage you all, too, to get out on social media and tweet or post in LinkedIn. Nice part about virtual, people can still join us this afternoon. They can join us tomorrow. We have a whole day of content. So please get on out there to social media and help us spread the word. And I think this next session will definitely be one that you will want to be posting about. It's a pleasure to have with us here Mike Cagney. Mike is the founder of SoFi and now Figure, along with some other really interesting stuff that I've done. Mike, it's really a pleasure for us to have you here. Thank you for joining us.
No, thanks for having me. I'm looking forward to the conversation.
Well, good. Well, I hope I don't mess it up. Mike has done so many fascinating things. He almost really doesn't need any introduction if you follow the technology space at all. Obviously, one of the big names that are out there, and we're thrilled that he could join us today. Let's start with, we did our prep. We talked about the fact that we weren't going to go too deep into blockchain technology because this is more of a generalist conference. But I think starting just with a high level, explain what Figure is, what Provenance is, what Hash is. People have probably heard all three of those, but give kind of the layman's understanding of the difference between all that stuff and what Figure really does.
Sure. So about 2 years ago, we wanted to use blockchain technology to deliver some efficiencies in the financial services ecosystem. And the premise is, if you think about how finance works today, there's so much intermediation with custodians, trustees, administrators, et cetera. And our view was we could use blockchain technology to drive some efficiency there. And one of the challenges is, blockchain's been heavily hyped and not a lot's been delivered against it in terms of real economic value and real production adoption. And so we wanted a use case that was tangible, that was salient, that had a real economic benefit associated to it. And we set out to do a securitization on blockchain. So originate digital assets on blockchain, finance them on blockchain, securitize them on blockchain. And the idea was we felt we could drive about 90 basis points of efficiency using the technology. So from reduction of audit and QC expenses to more streamlined ability to pledge assets into warehouses to changing the structure of securitization, eliminating the pay agent, the custody bank, and so forth, and creating better liquidity for those securities in a marketplace subsequent to the transaction. And the challenge that we had in trying to take this distributed trustless immutable technology and bundle it as a ledger, a registry, and exchange, is that when we took it to market a couple of years back, everyone said, this is great technology. We agree with the premise behind this, but the world's not ready for it. And so why don't we do proof of concepts or other things that we can do? And we didn't want to do that. We really felt it was important to bring something into production and demonstrate whether the economics were really there or not. And so we ended up creating Figure as a financial services platform. So Figure was literally created to be a first mover on Provenance blockchain. So Provenance is the name of the blockchain that we created. And what we did is we went to the buy side and we said, hey, we're generating, in the case of our first assets, HELOCs, these really interesting HELOC assets, secured collateral, very high coupon, we think great credit performance. Do you want to buy them? And we went to the usual suspects of buy side firms and universally everyone wanted to buy these assets. And we said, great, you got to buy them on blockchain. And everyone said, well, why do I got to buy them on blockchain? Like, why can't I just buy them the way I've always bought them? And we said, because the only reason we're originating these assets is for blockchain. So you're going to buy them on blockchain. And we went through the education process. And as you can imagine, there was a lot of education around, what we have is what's called a distributed stakeholder blockchain. So what that means is there are 12 financial institutions that sit in this blockchain. And they're names you've heard of, like Franklin Templeton and Experian and others. And effectively what they're doing is they're validating the transactions in this blockchain. And so walking through and explaining to firms how their data is protected, how other firms don't see their trades, how they have ownership of their assets, it was a significant and involved process. And everyone kept reverting back to, well, is this crypto? Is this, is this Bitcoin? And we said, look, Bitcoin is run on a blockchain, but blockchain is not Bitcoin. And in the beginning, I made a mistake structurally because there is a token on the blockchain called hash. And what hash is for is to capture the distribution of the economics of the blockchain. So when you transact on Provenance, you pay a third of the benefit that you get. So if I'm cutting my warehousing costs by 51 basis points, I pay 17 basis points to transact. Originally, I made the mistake of making that 17 basis points payable in hash. And so there was this crypto asset that you'd have to buy to transact. And everyone said, well, what if the price is too high? What if I can't buy it? And there were good answers to all these things, but it just got too confusing. And what we ended up doing is saying, look, you're just going to pay fiat currency. You're going to pay dollars to transact on a blockchain. You don't even know that there's hash there. And what we do every day on Provenance is we take all the dollars that are paid in and we distribute them out to the hash holders through an auction process. And so hash is kind of like the equity in a blockchain. It's the equity in a company. The key is the blockchain doesn't have an owner. It doesn't have a corpus. So Figure built this blockchain, but we don't own it. We don't control it. If you want to go on the blockchain, I can't stop you from doing it. I can't stop you from using the SDK to build applications on it. And so effectively what we're doing is using hash as a mechanism. It's kind of like stock in a company that has no cost structure and dividends out its earnings every day. And so in getting the buy side engaged and addressing this whole issue of, is this a crypto asset or not? We then went to the sell side and said, like, your clients are buying assets on here. You need to finance them. And you know, got some early movers with Jefferies and then Nomura. And now, you know, we have a host of banks on here. But basically that kicked off the ecosystem. We had to answer questions around enforceability of contract. We had to, you know, make sure the SEC bought off on it. And you know, we're very fortunate that Arthur Levitt and Sheila Bair are both advisors of ours and helped us navigate some of the regulatory structure that we had to get through. And got it into production and ended up that first securitization, which it was a slightly long path. We completed it right before the COVID crisis really hit the financial market. So early March, we ended up documenting about 135 basis points from origination through to execution using the technology. But it's just one use case. And we have use cases on fund custody and admin. We have use cases on banking and payments, which is, you know, hopefully something we'll spend some time talking about today. You know, we see this as kind of the most formative and disruptive technology that's been in the financial ecosystem since, you know, probably back to the spreadsheet.
Yeah, it's fascinating. And I will confess, I didn't know that until I started doing more research, but the amount and to the extent that you kind of needed to create the whole ecosystem for this in order for Figure to work. And I think, you know, we run a FinTech accelerator. Matter of fact, the class 12 is pitching later tonight if you want to join us. And I'll tell you, you know, if a FinTech founder had come to us with this business proposal, the one you just laid out, there is no way we would have bought off on it, right? How much of the fact that it was Mike Cagney and your success, your Rolodex, your connection, did it take someone with the amount of reputational muscle you had to be able to do this?
Yeah, I think it's one of the unique situations that we were in, which is we had the technical prowess to actually build this blockchain. You know, we were fortunate from some of our advisors, like Blythe Masters is one of our advisors and helped us a lot on the architecture and scalability of the blockchain. And you know, June and her team did a phenomenal job building it out and deploying it. But it was coupled with the fact that we had credibility with the buy side to actually generate assets and credibility with the sell side to finance high quality assets. And so, you know, we ended up pumping well over $1 billion of assets through Provenance to get to that first securitization. And that's sort of a missing piece that a lot of people don't have. And we did it very profitably too. So, you know, our lending business, while the genesis of that was as a first mover on blockchain and to de-risk these blockchain use cases, it is on its own right a very effective business and very high contribution margin business.
Yeah, you talked about how you had to adjust so that people didn't have to buy a hash and could just use fiat currency in order to make it happen. And there's a theme here about how you worked very hard to make the blockchain component of this almost transparent, right, or opaque, I guess, to the people that are getting the benefit of it. Talk about the philosophy of how, for consumers and for people, you're just trying to get to the end benefit without them having to understand the technology.
Exactly right, and I think one of the key elements of blockchain is it supports bilateral transactions, and whether those are institutional transactions or retail transactions, and the premise is that the blockchain's a registry. And so one of the key elements of this is you still need a bridge between blockchain and fiat currency. So if I'm going to sell you $50 million of loans, you got to put $50 million somewhere. And we were fortunate to get a set of early moving banks to act as what we call omnibus banks, which are sort of bridges between blockchain and fiat. So when I sell you $50 million loans, you put $50 million into one of these banks. They deliver effectively stable coin for you on the blockchain. The blockchain knows you own the coin, it knows I own the loans, it knows we've agreed to a transaction, and it effectively re-registers the ownership of coins to meet loans to you at those transaction terms. why this is so important is that that's a real-time transaction. It's bilateral. There's no counterparty risk. There's no settlement risk. And it introduces a rubric of which you can extend out to lots of applications outside of capital markets. You can extend it into banking and payments and retail banking in particular. And the key is, it's not that I know there's a blockchain. I didn't have to go buy Bitcoin. I didn't have to go buy Ether. I log into the same URL that I log in on traditional online transaction points. If you're a Figure customer, you take a HELOC. It's originated on blockchain. It's digitally native on blockchain through its whole life. You don't know that. You're completely abstracted from the fact of the underlying technology. And that's how it should work, because the technology, it shouldn't be that because it's blockchain, it should be because it's doing something better, right? It's making something happen that couldn't happen before. It's eliminating intermediation. It's reducing staffing costs and improving efficiency, right? That's what's more salient than the label blockchain.
Yeah. Do you think people have started to get that? Because I remember saying 2 or 3 years ago, right? Founders would come to us and say, we have a blockchain company. It's like, No, tell me what you do. I understand blockchain is a tool. You have a blockchain company. You have a company that's doing something, lending or that. Do you think that is starting to happen now? Do you think we've gotten past the hype of that and people are starting to understand what the heck blockchain is as a tool? Or do you still think there's just generally a ton of misinformation and misunderstanding out there?
I think it's a complicated question. I think in 2018 we hit the hype, you know, the peak of the hysteria, and that was the ICO peak, and everyone's like, well, I'm going to create a token, I'm going to sell the token, and the token's going to have value. And you say, well, why is it going to have value? And it's like, because there's only so much of it. Like, I don't understand that. And if you look at history, you know, Bitcoin being an exception, virtually anything whose value is driven on scarcity doesn't persist as value. That whole ICO process, I think, actually damaged the progress of blockchain. It took a lot of very, very good intellectual capital and diverted it into something that I understand the economic motivation to do it, but the long-term benefit wasn't there. Long-term impact of the technology wasn't there. And it actually set us back some, I think. And then today, I think one of the challenges is it's still an abused term in the sense that, I would fundamentally say that blockchain is a decentralized system. A lot of people say, I run a blockchain, but it's under my control. I don't exactly know what that means. And I'm not disparaging that or saying that that's right or wrong. It's I think there's a lot of ambiguity as to what it actually means today. And it's still not been well defined. And I think, we're trying to define an example of a decentralized chain that's in production, that scales, that has broad both industry and regulatory buy-in. But ours won't necessarily be the only one that pursues that path. And whether it ends up that private chains are more prevalent than public chains or what have you, I'm not sure. But we've taken a path that we think is right.
Yeah. All right. Well, let me move a little bit off the technology now. You talked a little bit from the bank side, the marketplace side, the benefit, right? Cost efficiencies, visibility. From the consumer side, why should consumers care? Why is this going to feel better to consumers?
Yeah, it's a combination of consumers and merchants, and it's really looking at what we have today, which is a very antiquated payment structure. A great illustration of this antiquated payment structure is government distribution into consumers. I always start with Katrina back in 2005 and the challenge the government had and how do we get stimulus payments to people that don't have bank accounts. Today there's almost 9 million people in the country that don't have a bank account. And the government has this problem today. But with Katrina, they said, well, we use prepaid debit cards and that'll be our solution. And the amount of fraud they had in distribution was north of 16%. So over $1 billion of fraud, predominantly through prepaid debit. And because the problem is, if you got that card, no one can control what I spend it on. No one can control if I was the right person to spend it. There are a bunch of issues related to that. And if you fast forward to today, to the stimulus distribution, about 20 million people still haven't gotten stimulus checks, and 8 million of those are unbanked U.S. consumers. And because IRS doesn't have a mechanism to get them that money, they can't do a direct deposit. And when they ultimately get around to mailing them that physical check, unfortunately, that person's going to have to go to a check cashing store and pay 10% to get their money. So if you think about this, the people that really need this money the most are last in line to get it and actually pay the most to access that cash. And it's an illustration of something that I think the blockchain technology can address. And I think if you take a step back to the concept I talked about earlier about an omnibus bank. So basically a bridge between blockchain and fiat currency. If you had a bank that collected dollars and integrated into the Fed settlement system, and then rather than that bank running a bank account ledger for consumers, you basically on the blockchain created a ledger for the consumer. So, you know, you and I, Dan, we can have accounts on there. They're not bank accounts. They're effectively, you know, call it a financial platform account, or there's still a KYC AML requirement, a BSA requirement and so forth, but it's not an FDIC bank account. And the premise is that you and I can deposit our check, hit the ATM, do all kinds of different things with this account. And that's going to get settled through a Fed ledger. The Fed ledger is going to notify this omnibus bank of the settlement. The omnibus bank is effectively creating and destroying stable coins on that blockchain as fiat moves in and out of its ledger. So, you know, when you go and hit the ATM for $200, it's going to destroy $200 of stablecoin on the blockchain. And the blockchain is going to know to go to Dan's account and debit him $200 of stablecoins for this. So what you're doing is you're taking the role that a profile or, you know, a traditional banking platform software would have performed, and you're abstracting it away from the bank. So the bank is now not necessarily facing directly to the consumer, which is a big cost and a big burden. It, you know, I go all the way back to my banking days where, you know, our rule was always 80-20, that 20% of our retail customers were profitable and 80% weren't. And you take that onus away from the bank of having to deal with that and focus it more in sort of a correspondent basis. And so you have a banking ledger that we think operates very efficiently at a very low cost. If you compare it to a traditional bank account where you have a minimum balance that you need to get it profitable, or you compare it to prepaid debit where there's a lot of fees laden in that, it's a much better consumer solution. But the real key on this is it provides a medium to move value. And in particular, if I want to pay you $100, I no longer have to go through an ACH rail or an interchange rail. I can basically agree to transact with you just like we do in any other transaction on a blockchain. It's bilateral. You know, blockchain knows I own stablecoin, it knows you own an account, and it knows to then ledger my stablecoin into your account. And again, you don't see it as stablecoin, you see it as dollars, right? So if I owe you $100, I can effectively pay you $100 and we ledger that blockchain over, or that stablecoin over through the blockchain. And the key on this is by avoiding interchange, we're avoiding the cost, the chargebacks, the settlement time associated with it. And it doesn't matter if you're a consumer or a business in this construct. So, and the beauty is if you do this through mobile, I can use the NFC chip in that phone and I can hit an NFC ATM, I can hit an NFC merchant kiosk, right? I can transact all the places I would normally transact. Online, I can scan a QR code and I can transact that way. And so our view on this is that there's, you know, finally, after many, many decades, a viable alternative to a rail system, to the interchange rail system that's been, you know, obviously owned and dominated by Visa, MasterCard, and Amex for so long. There's a viable alternative. And if you extend this into stimulus distribution, the beauty of this is those almost 9 million households that don't have bank accounts, they don't need a bank account. They can just register on a platform like this. You can go through the identity verification, KYC, AML. You can do that online. You can do that through a physical location like a post office or something similar. And the government can distribute that stimulus check into that omnibus bank. It can create that blockchain ledger stablecoin into that individual's account. And it's just as easy as them going to an NFC-enabled ATM and pulling the fiat currency out. Right, or going online and transacting, you know, at an online grocer or whatever the case might be, and the beauty of this is that those stable coins, you can put a smart contract on them, and so I can say, look, the stable coins I'm delivering to Dan, he can't spend it on alcohol, he can spend it on groceries, right? And so now you know, it's crazy if you read the Katrina stories about some of the things people spent money on. It, you know, I'd encourage you, if you ever have a free minute, to Google it, because it's an interesting illustration of what people spend money on. But you can manage that level of fraud, and you can ensure that the dollars go to where they're supposed to go. And the beauty of this is this technology exists today. In fact, we do this all the time on the commercial side, and we're now starting to do it on the consumer side of building these rails to allow people to transact this way.
Yeah, and with the penetration of smartphones being even higher than, you know, bank accounts, there's a mechanism for people to do that, right? So that wouldn't have been true 5 years ago, 10 years ago, but certainly is true now.
Absolutely, and not just the benefit of, or the advent of smartphones, but the advent of biotechnology to access those smartphones. And so you no longer have a card, And so if you think about it, your biometric signature is one of the key shards that creates your unique key that allows you to transact. And you no longer have a card, you no longer have an account number. So all the aspect of someone stealing your card number, all that goes away, right? All that fraud has disappeared. And you're right, it's the advances in biotech and mobile and the prevalence of NFC and the development of scalable blockchain technology that can actually handle millions of transactions, you know, per turn that have made this possible.
Yeah, but it's interesting, you know, I don't want to dwell too long on this, but the point you make about the distribution of funds, right? We've had a couple of sessions already in the morning talking about the stimulus that went out and trying to move that much money that quickly, trying to figure out where it all went, who it went to, trying to trace it all. And if we had had something like you described in place, how completely different the process would have been, the trackability would have been, and really the impact of it, right? I mean, we know we're marginalizing the impact because of the inefficiency of how it's been done, just because that's what the way it is. It's interesting to see where that'll go in the future.
Yeah, and I think that's an important thing. I think you flip the paradigm on its head, and it's not, you know, ex post tracing the spending. It's ex ante knowing it can be spent in the right places. And I think one of the other interesting paradigms you flip in this structure that I just described is, and if you think about, you know, a few years back, there was a merchant consortium done through MCX called Currency. And the merchants got together and said, we're tired of paying interchange. You know, we're going to create our own alternative payment system. And it didn't succeed. And there were a couple of really salient reasons why it didn't succeed. One was it wasn't interoperable to interchange. So it was either you could use a currency rail or not with this card. But the other, and I think the more prevalent one is they went after these consumers that have 4% cashback reward Visa cards and said, hey, you should use this and get nothing. And that's not how you're going to build a base in this. And I think a much more interesting customer segmentation is underbanked, unbanked, in particular, folks with thin files where you can do some stuff around microcredit extension, again, through geolocation. Like I know you've walked into a Walmart, I can push you a credit notification at that point, significantly changes my underwriting dynamic and risk dynamic, but help those people build credit. But I think the more prevalent aspect is, you know, that's a consumer that needs a solution, and that's where you build the beachhead. And ultimately, this solution grows. And what it does is it flips the paradigm where it's not the card company incenting the behavior with a rewards program anymore. It's the merchant incenting the behavior to avoid interchange. And I think that's a super interesting dynamic that comes out of this. And I'm sure a lot of the bankers in the audience aren't super thrilled to hear me say that. But there's
well, speaking of the bankers in the audience, I can't tell how many people have dropped out of the conversation already in protest, Mike, but I think everyone's still with us. Speaking of the audience, though, we did get a question from the audience. I should mention to everyone watching, if you want to put questions in the Brella chat, I'll try and get to as many as I can with Mike. We can talk with Mike for 2 hours and then not cover all the things we could possibly cover. But here's a question that came up. Does the use of blockchain tech in financial transactions create a situation where there's less autonomy, potentially, for the end user?
So I don't think so. And I think, in fact, it gives the end user much more information and control. So I'll give you a good example. We on a regular basis, run bid one in competition for loan pools. So once a week, we'll send a notification out that we've got, you know, X million dollars of loans up for bid, and different banks can log in. They can do the diligence and the collateral. They submit the bids through. And the loan level detail they get down to the packet, every piece of information. So there's blockchain smart contracts that do audit of the loan origination. So, you know, is the FICO, is the DTI, are the CLTV numbers correct? Are all the documents that need to be in the packet there? But then the packet's there for review as well. So the extent that you want to do loan level diligence. And so, you know, going back to pre-blockchain when we would originate assets, just the difficulty of getting files out, even e-files from vaulting services into diligence providers, this is an infinitely better way to do that. But the other interesting aspect around blockchain in terms of autonomy is and control is it's a real-time system. So what that means is when we get payments back, that remittance isn't aggregated up and distributed once a month with a remit report. You see real-time that the loan's paid. So it's out in California right now, it's 11:31 a.m. I can log on and see every loan that's paid me as of 11:31 a.m. today that should have paid me today. And so think about this in the current market and the dislocation we've had in mortgage. So, you know, in particular, prime jumbo, that market shut down because no one wanted to buy that collateral because they were getting at least 30 day stale reports on the performance of those underlying assets. They said, well, I have no idea how many of these people have gone into forbearance in the last 30 days. Right? Somewhat unprecedented situation with the massive amount of unemployment that happened over a short period of time, but still that caused illiquidity, it caused the market to shut down. In the context of blockchain, you've got transparency and you know exactly what's happening to the assets and you know exactly where they are today. And I think what you're doing in doing that is you're creating more liquidity and you're creating liquidity and you're eliminating the intermediation of the broker that traditionally sat between the buyer and the seller. And you're allowing the seller to then remarket that collateral back into the same marketplace. I think you're actually giving a lot more control and autonomy to the end user in that construct.
Does this, and this may be a stupid question, but the question came up about the end user, but doesn't this fundamentally make the American and global financial ecosystem stronger, right? Doesn't it make it more resilient to crises?
Infinitely. And I think this goes back to, you know, one of the questions, when we came out of the crisis in 2008, 2009, you know, we all looked at each other and said, we're never gonna let that happen again. And we're going to build these robust market ecosystems, you know, with transparency and real-time settlement, and, you know, blah, 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 blah. And then, you know, inertia took over. We got a year into it and things started to get better. And we said, we'll get to it later. And you know, what's the chance of that happening again? And then, of course, it happened again. And you know, again, the idea that prime jumbo residential mortgage-backed market could completely collapse as fast as it did, completely shut down, no bid, should be terrifying to any market participant, right? That is an underlying asset that, you know, has stayed very liquid even back in 8-9. You know, it's still traded. You might not like the price it traded at, but it's still traded. The fact that the liquidity evaporated, the bids just disappeared because nobody knew what was going on with the collateral is a terrifying event. And I'm hoping that we're going to come out of the current market dislocation with a commitment to actually build true transparency and true liquidity so that we can withstand these kinds of disruptions. And again, you might not like the price it's trading at, but the key is as long as it's trading.
Yeah. Here's another good one. I bet you'll have an opinion on this one. Do you see the US government ever issuing a central bank digital currency?
Yeah, so I think this is the big conversation that everyone's having. And I think that what I described earlier in the construct of a single bank creating that stable coin, the reality is you can have multiple banks minting stablecoin onto a blockchain. Those stablecoins are fungible between the banks. But you could also say, maybe it's just the Fed, and maybe the Fed does that. And then it you effectively are moving towards the premise of digital dollar. I think that there's a lot of challenges around digital dollar. There's, you know, some great, the Christian Carlo's effort with the Digital Chamber of Commerce, I think is a good direction. And there's a lot of really interesting literature around that and the work they're doing with Accenture. But I think that the interim step is effectively creating a fungible stable coin across banks. And by the way, when I said some of the banks might like my interchange comment, the banks still play a critical role in the ecosystem I've laid out. So you're not disintermediating the banks. In fact, what you're doing is you're changing some of their old line business. Like, you know, the idea that you can broker loans and still make money, that probably goes away. But you as a lender, for example, you now have infinitely better transparency into your collateral, infinitely better effectiveness in terms of securing that collateral and you know, in the event of breach of covenant, taking that collateral. So I think it slightly changes the business shift, but the banks are still integral in the structure that I described. I think the stablecoin premise will supersede any notion of digital dollar. And digital dollar is introduces some really interesting and complicated questions that we haven't solved yet. So I absolutely see the government stepping through. What I described really basically catches us up to what WeChat and Alipay are doing in China right now, right? But they're doing it on their own rails. And I think that the blockchain rails as decentralized is a much more robust way to solve that problem. And it eliminates the notion of single party risk on a transaction being the rail operator.
Yeah. Another question that came in related to something we've already talked about. So you may have touched on it a little bit, but someone wanted to hear your opinion regarding how blockchain, you know, can or cannot help address racial and social economic issues in the financial sectors. You know, clearly you already talked about the 9 million banked or underbanked and how it can impact, but how else could it have an impact in there?
Well, I think that in itself, you know, if you look at the African American community within that unbanked population, they unfortunately make up a disproportionate majority of, or segment of that, and you know, we've not thought a lot about inclusion within financial services, and some of this goes back to that 80-20 rule I talked about in terms of a retail bank operation. It's very difficult for a bank, a traditional bank using traditional infrastructure and traditional technology, to cost effectively deliver solutions to low balance customers, but they need the solutions. And more importantly, they need access to credit. They need the ability to build credit files, right? To go from a thin file to a thick file, or go from, you know, a subprime to a prime borrower base. Financial literacy can help that as well, which, you know, obviously is outside of blockchain. So I see the technology being a way to liberate access to a payment rail system. And effectively eliminating a lot of the intermediation. Like check cashing is a horrible intermediation, right? Payday lending, horrible intermediation. So let me expand on the stablecoin solution I just talked about earlier. Talk about the consumer aspect. Well, because it's geolocation to mobile. If you're an employer, if I work at Walmart, when I walk into the store, we can start paying you the moment you walk through the store door. And when you leave, we can pay you that day through this technology. And you're not waiting 2 weeks for a paycheck. You're not hitting a payday lender at, you know, 60-100% interest rates. And it's not that Walmart pays people every 2 weeks because they want the float, right? There is no float right now. You're zero on your cash balances. It's because of the technical complexity and infrastructure. This addresses a lot of that. And I think that's a huge benefit to hourly employees to be able to get them paid every day. Because right now the system is biased against them, you know, between payday lending, between check cashing, you know, all these prepaid debit, all these things are just laden with fees. And the technology can disintermediate a lot of that, what I would call rent seeking that exists in that segment.
Yeah. It's fascinating stuff. And I think it'll be hard, I think, for most average consumers even to understand 10 years from now what it will look like and how much impact it'll have. I think you started the conversation with this, right? Unfortunately, blockchain got a little overheated, overhyped, and then I think people turned a little sour on it. But I think in the future, it'll be just so fundamental to how it makes people's lives better and some of the stuff that's going on.
Yep.
Let's change gears a little bit. What's also fascinating, we're flying through the time. I haven't even really touched on this yet. You're the founder of, I said, when we did a prep call, you know, two fintech unicorns, and you mentioned that, well, actually it's three with the blockchain that you created, right? There's so different people in the world that have started three fintech unicorns. And so I want to talk a little bit about your entrepreneurial experience. Let's start with this one, which is for Figure. Where did the idea for Figure come from? Was it an aha, lightning bolt strike of inspiration? Was it a slow build over time or a frustration you saw out there? How did that idea come to market?
Well, I think that in general, there was an underlying frustration that FinTech 1.0 never really did what it was supposed to do. Right. So if you think back to, you know, call it 2012, 13, the technology was going to change the world. Right. And it was going to do all these wonderful things. And you know, some of the early companies that went public came out at extremely high valuations. And there was a lot of exuberance. And at the end of the day, you know, and I don't want to be too cynical on it because my peers beat me up when I say that. But there, we didn't really change a lot. Right. I mean, we took an offline process and we put it online. Yeah, but basically, you know, the nuts and bolts, you know, weren't all too dissimilar from what they'd always been, and so I always had this underlying frustration that, you know, there was a way for us to really, really change the financial ecosystem, and I felt that all the way back to when I was working in the bank, back in the late '90s, and the challenge I had was I'd given blockchain a lot of lip service, you know, up until, you know, call it 2018. I never really understood what it meant. And if you put a gun to my head, you know, I couldn't probably give you a better answer than Bitcoin. And so it was actually in late 18, I was thinking through and actually reading a really rudimentary article about blockchain. It literally had like cartoon graphics explaining what was going on. And because that's what, I mean, I'm not the smartest person, so I needed some cartoons to on this. And I got the aha. And I said, oh man, like this changes everything. And I actually understood, you know, the role of ledger registry exchange and bilateral transactions and immutable data and trustless process, you know, trustless infrastructure And I started thinking, you know, there's a, the top three custody banks have $150 billion of market cap, and the top seven or eight exchanges have $125 billion of market cap. And both, just off the bat, both those businesses disappear with this technology. And by the way, it's not adversarial to most of the financial ecosystem. So most banks can't stand paying the custodial fees and administrator fees and exchange fees and all the other things that they have to pay. You know, that's all revenue that, or all economic that comes back to them. And I said, this is a great situation where, you know, I can actually do something that's aligned to the majority of the financial ecosystem, but it's huge in terms of dollar impact and huge in terms of social impact, of, you know, what it actually is going to do for everyone that participates in it.
Is that, at this point, is that what motivates you? I mean, it's interesting. You've been so successful and already had massive impacts on there. What drives you at this point? What gets you fired up every day to get out of bed? Is it that changing people's lives? Is it something else?
Yeah, I think, and like I've been fortunate enough to have a couple of really successful endeavors in my history, and you know, and I've learned a lot from those endeavors, and I haven't done them all the right way either, and I've taken a lot of lessons out of that as well. You know, I think at this point I'm really looking for something transformative and impactful. It was funny when I was starting Figure, you know, Yuri Milner, who's the head of DST, had a conversation with me and basically said, if I can't build a $100 billion business, don't start it. And I kind of laughed at him, and I was like, you know, there's not like a lot of $100 billion businesses running around out there. And that was what was so interesting when I hit the aha moment, is that, you know, I just talked about 270 billion of market cap you can displace with this technology. I was like, this is a $100 billion business. You know, and it's not that I'm looking at that in terms of personal enrichment. I'm looking at that as a measure of the impact it's going to have in the ecosystem we operate in.
Yeah. As an entrepreneur, right? Teams are critically important to that. What do you look for when you hire people? What are the characteristics? Do you have a short list? Is it really specific to the job? I noticed on Twitter, by the way, I think you're looking for, is it a chief credit officer? We should give your job opening a plug. What do you look for in people?
So I'm looking for a chief credit officer. I'm looking for a head of lending operations too. And I'm hiring in Charlotte, by the way. So building a presence local to you. So
This is big news. It didn't come up in our pre-call. Talk about jobs in Charlotte for a second.
So CD Davies, who runs all our lending, is based there. And we're right now, we have loan operations in Reno, Nevada. And we'd like bi-coastal representation for a whole host of reasons, you know, disaster recovery and time zone redundancy and so forth. So we've decided to build a second operations center out of Charlotte. Most likely our head of operations will be located there, and potentially our head of credit will be there as well. Although head of credit, you know, they can work anywhere. We've all, on the back of this, the last 2.5 months, realized that you can actually work pretty much anywhere and be effective. So we're not so much worried about their geographic location. But I think going back to your point, yeah, one of the mistakes I made historically is the way I used to think about hiring was basically your history, your ability, your skills, and then the culture fit. And culture was always a distant third, almost a little bit of a lip service to me in terms of yeah. And you know, historically the challenges come out of that is you know, I tolerate people that were jerks, or, you know, for better word, you know, a-holes. I don't want to say swear when we're on a video conference, but because they could deliver and they do a really good job, and you'd be like, okay, well, I can look past the fact that you're a jerk. I don't do that at Figure, and it's been a huge learning experience for me of how effective, how much any individual is outweighed by a cohesive unit that rose together. That was something that if you asked me that 3 or 4 years ago, of course I would nod and say, yes, I agree, but really I probably wouldn't. Yeah. And now, you know, I definitely buy into that. It's a culture first hiring process. Do you fit into the way that we do things? Do you care about the things we care about? And if that works, then you go into, can you do the job?
Yeah, it is interesting. I think there's a macro shift of, you know, venture capitals wants to make money. People invest in the stock market want to make money. But there's also an understanding there are other stakeholders, other shareholders that need to get balanced, maybe more than we have in the past as an economy. It'll be interesting to see where that trend goes as well.
Yeah, I think to build on that, the way that we think about it is you have three constituents in a business. You have your investors, which is a third. You have your employees, which are a third. You have your customers, which are a third. And the important dynamic on that is you know, as it relates to your investors, it's not that you do everything you can at the cost of the other two groups to generate the best return, but also for your employees, it's not that, you know, for example, things that we used to say, like the customer is always right. Well, they're actually not always right. And you should stick up for your employees when the customer is wrong. And you know, they don't need to get, you know, if you're a service on the operations side, you don't need to get called and yelled at and sworn at and so forth. You should be professional, but there's only so much you have to take. And I think you're kind of managing the fact that you have three constituents and treating them all equally helps a lot in terms of alignment and what you want to do right from a business standpoint.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, unfortunately, we're going to run out of time. Like I said, I could sit here and chat with you all day. You're a fascinating person to talk with. Let's kind of focus on the entrepreneurs at the end. I think a lot of the fintech founders who are listening in on this too, what advice would you give them? And I know we kind of all have our go-to advice as entrepreneurs. What do you think is a piece of advice maybe that founders don't hear often enough and they ought to pay more attention to than they normally hear?
So I think a couple of things. I think one, you know, being a founder, especially a founder CEO, is extremely hard. It is a very lonely job. It is not a job if you're looking for lots of positive reinforcement that you should pursue, because you're not going to get a lot of attaboys or attapersons as a founder CEO. You know, it has to be something that's driven by conviction and desire and what you want to do and what you want to build out. I think this is a phenomenal time to start a business, because during periods of dislocation, when things look really difficult, this is the right time. And you end up getting a lot of entrepreneurial efforts, not just in the fintech side, but across everywhere when you have job losses and dislocation like this, because it provides an impetus for people to take a risk, because, you know, what's the downside at this point? But it's a phenomenal time to be an entrepreneur right now, because there are so many problems that need to be addressed and the tools and resources that you have. I mean, I just think back. My first startup was in early 2000. And back then we had to buy machines and host web logic and Oracle data. I mean, it would cost you like $2 million to get out of the gate to put up a website, right? And then, you know, just it would cascade from there. Like now, the friction, the startup cost to build presence is de minimis. And so, you know, it's a great opportunity. It's a great window to be an entrepreneur. I think that the key lesson that I've had to learn, and sometimes the hard way, is, you know, don't let success go to your head. Just stay grounded. And if you don't stay grounded, you're going to screw up. And sometimes it's hard, right? Especially, you know, I talk to a lot of these younger entrepreneurs and you know, who are in their 20s, they're getting really good success. And, you know, and honestly, a lot of them think that there's a term we use that your poop doesn't stink, but we use a different term than poop. But, and the reality is everyone's does. And so, like, if you start a company, if you get success, just stay grounded to your principles. And if you do that, you'll be okay.
Yeah, well, that's awesome. Unfortunately, I kind of have to wrap us up there, but with a big thank you, Mike. I really appreciate it. I hope people, you know, we talked to our founders about the fact that these really strange times is a lot of disruption and sometimes very painful financial and health disruption, but with disruption comes opportunity, right? We were preaching that to our founders. It's what you just said, and I think you all are really well positioned with the disruption in the marketplace to be able to move forward. And I'm sure we're going to see really fascinating things in the future. And I hope some of those things you talked about do happen, because I think it'll make all of our lives better and more productive. Also, thanks to the CD Davies. You mentioned him. CD is one of our mentors at the QC FinTech program, also one of the investors in our FinTech fund, is doing some work with Mike. And that's actually how we made the connection. So a shout out to CD and the ability also to bring some of a little bit of the Figure team to Charlotte, which of course we love. And maybe we should have done Open Arms. We're going to welcome you with Open Arms. There's what should have been our walkaway music. A little late to the party on that one in my head.
That's all right.
Closing to comment here, though, this segment was brought to you by RevTech Labs. That's obviously the accelerator and technology company that we started here, incorporating Packard Place, the Entrepreneurship Center, QC FinTech, QC Health Tech, also the conferences. So RevTech Labs was able to help put this lesson on. Mike, I'll give you the, before I give you the last word, the next segment coming up here in a little bit, folks, is on the Not All Banks Are Created Equal with some fantastic folks from Level, Vero, and Truist that start almost right after this in the Brella app. So that's my plug for the next section. Mike, any last words before we let everyone go to the break?
I just want to thank you for having me and say that the next section sounds pretty good. So I hope people stay on for that one.
Well, you're welcome. Welcome to tune in if you have any time. So,
excellent.
Maybe you can surprise everyone and be like Shark Tank, and you can surprise come into our demo day and fire off questions at people.
Indeed.
Well, thanks again, Mike. Really enjoyed it and take care. Enjoy the rest of your day.
Thank you.
All right. Thanks so much.